welcome everyone. It's really good to see you. I was a little bit nervous when I set up for church this morning because the news reports just predicted all this mayhem on the roads, but I shouldn't have worried. You're a hearty bunch that live out here and you're used to it, and I made it okay too, so that's good. I like to look at our announcements first because they represent the life and work of the church. There's service times for Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. Kirkwall Presbyterian Church is having a blue Christmas. I think that's tonight at 5 p.m. That is for people who are struggling at Christmas time. If you're experiencing loss or illness, something that makes it hard for you to celebrate, but you still need support, then that's a good service to attend. Still looking for our talent show participants to come forward. And we really appreciate all the contact info that we've been receiving. That's really helpful. Are there any other announcements? How about birthdays? Okay, and I think we are ready to sing. We're only going to be singing 5 verses of the first hymn. O come, Emmanuel. This is 1-5. So I invite you to stand as you are leaving.
In this season of Advent,
as once again we wait the coming of the Christ child, may the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
In this, and I invite you now to join in saying the words of the call of worship that are printed in boldface type. It's Advent. We are waiting for a special baby's birth. In anticipation, each week we light another candle. Candles of hope, peace, and joy.
Today we light a candle of love.
Where can we see the light of God's love shining?
In the faces of those who have received our gifts of warm mittens and socks.
Where do we feel the love of God?
In hearts that warm with the acts of kindness.
How do we share God's love?
Kindness is contagious. The love of God spreads across the land.
Tell me, who can count on God's love?
Everyone is worthy of God's love. God's love is for everyone.
I invite you now in. There's two instructions for Rock Town and Sheffield. Now, I invite you into a time of prayer. Let us pray. Dear God, you promise to always be with us, and we know that you are with us. It is harder, Lord, to see you sometimes and to feel you when there are acts of violence and hatred and just indifference that surround us. Lord, help us to see the hope, the joy, the peace that is possible in this season, and help us to see the ways that love breaks through into our lives. Be with us as we worship. Amen. And we will be singing Hope is a Star. We'll remain seated during this as our candlelighters come forward. It's dawn and there at night. They will light the candle of love for us. You can be singing as there are words for them to say, so that's what they're here, so.
We are open to your light. God is the journey of life. We are aware that the shadows do not hold the final answer, that despair is not the final emotion, and that disappointment is not the final destination when we open ourselves to your light, to your promise, and to your love. Be near to us as we approach the birth of the Holy Christ Child, and be reborn in our hearts this day, we pray.
And before we say our words of assurance, let's sing Hope is a Star.
Thank you.
Claudia, and to Shep, amen, as we give thanks for the birth of the Bethlehem baby, anticipated so long ago and still today. Through the birth of Jesus Christ, God reminded us that we are never lost or abandoned, for God is with us every step of the way.
Let us not be discouraged. Let us embrace courage and strength for the journey. Let us give thanks to God, now and always. Amen.
And I invite you to stand as you are able for the singing of Go, Tell It on the Mount.
Thank you. 10 times. I know, I hate when that happens. Where's Ethan? My shift is almost over, and he still hasn't shown up. I've got big plans. I don't know where he is. He should be here by now. Maybe he fell asleep. I wouldn't be surprised. Look who decided to show. What happened, Ethan? Did you get lost?
You wouldn't believe what just happened.
You're probably right. Let me guess, you took a bath? Hey, where's your new bagpipes? I thought you were going to entertain us tonight.
That's why I'm late. I was practicing my new bagpipes for hours, and then suddenly an angry wolf came out of nowhere. He snatched my bagpipes and took off.
What? Why would a wolf do that?
I don't know. He was angry.
Made the So he asked me if I would finish giving him out. So come on up, children, even the big children.
Joseph, son of David. David, do not be afraid to take Mary to be your wife, for it is by the Holy Spirit that she has conceived. She will have a son, and you will name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Now all this happened in order to make what the Lord had said through the prophet come true. A virgin will become pregnant and have a son, and he will be called Emmanuel, which means God is with us. So when Joseph woke up, he married Mary, as the angel of the Lord had told him to do.
May the words of my lips and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, Lord. Well, it's the fourth Sunday of Advent, and it seems like Advent is going on, and we've been waiting for a long time for Christmas Day. We wait with great anticipation to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. The Hebrew people waited hundreds of years, thousands even, for this event. Isaiah spoke of it in the Old Testament when he said, "For a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." These were encouraging words to people who had endured years of suffering and oppression. In the meantime, the people could have abandoned their God, the Hebrew God. They could have turned to any number of gods that were being worshipped at that time and in that place. It was a very multicultural, multi-religious area. But they didn't. Many remained faithful. What must it be like to wait and wait on a promise? It must have felt to them like the Messiah was never coming. The civilians trapped in Aleppo must feel something of what these people felt, waiting and waiting for help to arrive, and it's not coming, and they keep waiting. Questions that plague them will be, when will help come? Who will bring help? Can we trust them? It's really hard to remain hopeful when you are under siege. And in the Old Testament reading that we read today, Isaiah was talking to King Ahaz. And King Ahaz was a king of Jerusalem at the time, and they were under siege from three different armies. Two armies were allied against them and going to attack, and then there was a third army that was going to attack them. So Isaiah was saying to Ahaz, King Ahaz, you have to trust God. Trust God. And Isaiah, and ask God for a sign. Now, as Ahaz said, no, I'm not going to ask God for a sign. I don't want to. And the reason he didn't want to was that he'd already made up his mind about what he was going to do. Well, what he did ended up leading Jerusalem and its people to a time of war and destruction, waiting once again for a savior. There's a story I know, and the children might like to hear this story, because it's about a dog. There was a dog called Fido. So some of you may have heard him. If you go to a little town in Italy, there's a statue of this dog, because he was a really special dog. This dog lived on the streets. He didn't have an owner, he didn't have a collar, nobody to love him. And he used to go around and look for scraps of food. Sometimes he did dangerous things, like he would dart out into traffic to get a little piece of food. And one day he did that, and he got hit by a car. And he was hurt. was so sad. And then, as he lay there, just wondering if anyone would come and help him, a man came, was walking home from work, and saw the dog and picked him up and took him home and started to look after him. And that became his dog. And then every day, Fido would walk with his master to the bus, because the man would walk into town and take the bus to the factory where he worked. Well, he did this for like 2 years. He'd walk there, and then once his master got on the bus, he would sit and wait in the square for him to come home. And he knew exactly when the bus would arrive and when his master would get off. And when his master got off the bus, he would wag his tail, and they were both so happy to see each other. Well, this is when this story gets a little bit sad, because one day, Fido was waiting for his master, the bus came, and his master didn't get off the bus. And he didn't know. He didn't know what had happened. Where was his master? So he decided to walk home. He walked home. And the next day, he got up, and he went, and he walked again into the village to wait for his master. Once again, his master didn't get off the bus. Something, it seems, had happened to him. And this poor dog would go there every day to wait for his master, but his master wasn't coming home. And the people in the village started to notice. They started to see that this dog was all on its own. They started to notice what a wonderful friend and loyal, faithful dog he was. So they started to feed him and look after him. They would invite him to their homes, they would look after him, but always he wanted to go and wait in the square. Another time I'll tell you what happens, but the reason there is a statue to this dog is that he's so faithful, he loved his master, and he waited a long, long time. While he was waiting, God made sure he got the food and the love and the attention that he needed. You know, in sad circumstances, it's hard to see where God is. If you're a lonely dog waiting for your master, you wonder. People wonder, where is God in this? If you're someone living in Aleppo right now, where it's being attacked, and it's a war zone, the people there must be wondering, where is God in this? We often wonder that when we're facing trouble. And whenever you wonder where is God, it's a good idea to look to Jesus and to what Jesus represented and what Jesus did. One of the things that Jesus did was he was very, very kind to everyone. And he inspired other people to be kind. So if you want to look for God in places like Aleppo, where it seems that he can't possibly be there, look at the little acts of kindness that are happening there. They're not often the ones reported on the news, but there, I can assure you, there are people sharing food. There are people taking in orphans and widows. There's also a lot of bravery. There are doctors and different aid workers who could have left a long time ago who decided to stay and be courageous and be kind and help the people in need. That's where you'll find God. That's where you'll see God's love breaking in to our troubled world. And that's one of the reasons that we are so excited about Christmas, because we know what will happen. We know that what Jesus will bring to a troubled world. And we know that with Jesus' birth, the love of God will start breaking in all over, and that it will never be conquered or completely put out by the darkness. We see these loving acts of kindness, and they happen in our church when people at this time of year are really inspired to give. We may give at other times of the year, but this year, this time of year, we want to give more. Our hearts are less. They're softer. They're bigger. We want to do more. And that comes from seeing Jesus from learning from his teaching, from learning about his life. There, at this time of year, we are sharing what we have, the gifts that we can give with people in need. And if you want to see the love of God in action, you just have to look to all these caring acts. You have to look at the faces of the people that receive the mittens that we collected, the socks that we collected, that received the white gifts, the family that received all those gifts that we bought for them. And that's where you'll see the love of God shining strong. So when you get discouraged by the news where things seem dark and hopeless, remember that there is no place that God is not, and that God is working there too. And if you get discouraged by the commercialism of this season, remember that it can't stop the loving acts of kindness that go beyond giving a gift you buy from the store, that go towards helping those in need. I think Christmas, it makes us kinder. And the reason for the season is Jesus, the one who teaches us to be kind. Thanks be to God.
Yeah.
leadership has been part of the ARI since its inception. Participants learn about different models of leadership, such as those personified by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Mahatma Gandhi. At the core of this training is the belief that through understanding the current issues and developing management skills, the students will become effective leaders. One of the participants shared his understanding of servant leadership. A leader is not a commander, but serves the people. I got a real challenge and lesson from ARI on the role of the servant leader. The servant leadership models completely changed me. Staff were always practicing servant leadership, and that is why. It is not just taught and learned, but also practiced every day. All people are equal, no discrimination. I never learned this before. I know the words servant leadership as a Christian, but not in practice in a community. But from ARI, I really came to know its meaning. Working in partnership with the staff members and the work teams allows participants to learn what it means to both serve and follow. We are thankful for partners like Asian Rule Institute, where our mission and service gifts offer many an opportunity to learn what it truly means to lead and serve. Please join me in making mission and service giving a regular part of your life today. Please join me in prayer. Loving God, we are called to be your colors in the world, to walk with each other, to share in love for our gifts and mission and service. Guide us to shine brightly in the world. Amen.
She'll have our song after we take up the offering. So now we will be taking up our offering. After the offering, we'll be singing. Are not so apparent.
so obvious to all. Lord, we pray for people at this time of year who struggle, and because we know it is hard to be poor, it is hard to be sad or lonely or ashamed when everyone around you is celebrating. Lord, we know that these people need special love that comes from you and that comes from their friends and neighbors. Lord, may we be Christ to the people we meet. May we share the love that Christ brought to us with others. We think, Lord, at this particular time of the people of Aleppo, the people who remain, who are trapped, who are wanting to get out. Lord, may the world find ways to help them. May help come soon, and may it come effectively. Lord, we also pray for people who are struggling with family problems at this time of year, with children who are maybe not with them, with family divisions, or family problems. We pray, Lord, that you will help people be together to break down the barriers that separate them and bring them peace and joy at this time of year. Lord, we raise to you now, in the silence of our hearts, the special cares and concerns for the people we know need your loving help and attention. Lord, as we pray, the voices of children that are quietly talking in the background of our prayers remind us that with children there is hope and joy, and we ask for your special blessings upon them. Let us sing now the Lord's Prayer.
Next time.
maybe we'll learn it well enough to not need that. I don't think it was too challenging. It's almost harder the first time you try something. And now I invite you to, we're going to have to look in our books at Voices Narrative 71, for 'twas in the mood of wintertime.